A ver.
Bueno, buenos días. Gracias a todos por venir. Hoy tenemos la suerte de contar con Rafael Ramos, que viene, es investigador Ramón y Cajal, de la Universidad de Santiago de Compostela, y nos va a hablar de conversión termoeléctrica mediante corrientes de spin. Muchas gracias, Rafa.
Gracias.
Gracias, Irene, por la introducción. Como lo que voy a enseñar aquí lo he presentado casi siempre en inglés, voy a dar la charla en inglés, pero si queréis hacer preguntas, pues hacerlas como queráis. Ok. Bueno, como dijo Irene, ok, I'm going to switch to English. No. So I'm going to talk about thermoelectric conversion mediated by spin currents. Let me talk first a bit about my research travels. Actually, I did the undergraduate in the University of Santiago de Compostela. Then after finishing the undergraduate, I traveled to Ireland to do the PhD there in Trinity College. And then after that, I went as a postdoc to the INA in the group of Professor Ibarra. And actually this was in University of Zaragoza. This was a very good opportunity because I was able to participate in a very nice project with also a Japanese group of Professor Saito and Professor Makawa. And this was the start of my research on spin cyclic effect. So, and thanks to that, later I traveled to Japan as a postdoc to join the group of Professor Saito. And after a while, I was kind of a bit lost. What to do next? What would be the next step? But actually, finally, I managed to complete the circle. I now University of Santiago Compostela again as a Ramón y Cajal Fellow, basically starting research line there, working on spin calorimetrics, basically. Basically, I move on middle of the pandemic back to Santiago. You can see here some pictures of Haneda Airport in August 2020. Actually, this airport has around 250,000 passengers per day. And you can see on that day, it was completely empty. I think we were around 20 people in the airport. So let's get to the talk. This is the outline of my talk. I'm gonna first introduce thermoelectric conversion and some key concepts to understand the spin-Seebeck effect, show some basically also potential for applications. Then I move on to my main research results, which is enhancement of spin-Seebeck effect in multilayers. And finally, enhancement of spin-Seebeck effect by magnetic phonon resonance. So basically thermoelectrics usually is a niche subfield which has niche applications due to basically it's mostly used in space exploration or remote places where you don't need to have maintenance. Thermoelectrics have no moving parts, so don't need maintenance. This is an example. So this is a rover which has a thermoelectric generator, radioisotope thermoelectric generator. You have a material which generates heat and it expands radially, and with some thermoelectric materials you can generate electricity. And this is in this vehicle is somewhere here, and this is a type of device. However, thermoelectrics, you look at the efficiency, it's not very good. Efficiency is given by this expression. This is a Carnot efficiency, but then it's modulated by some thermoelectric figure of merit, which is given by this expression. It's interrelation between several material properties which are conflicting with each other. And usually best thermoelectrics are around 70 equals 2. You can see many other ways of producing energy are far above this. However, there is a lot of heat, which why not use it? We can have an example here. Of all the energy employed, around 2/3 are lost as heat. So there is a huge source of energy. Here we see another example in electronics. We can see that the size of cooling facilities as large as computing facility. And this type of problem is only being aggravated year by year because we have exponential increase of use of data and heat generated due to all this Internet of Things and machine learning and so on. So basically there is a big opportunity for thermoelectric conversion to employ, reuse all this energy. So I'm gonna start now talking about some basics. So first, thermoelectric conversion, which is usually given by Seebeck effect. You have a applied thermal gradient, you generate a longitudinal voltage with a proportionality factor, which is given by Seebeck coefficient. And as I showed before, the figure of merit is given by this relation between thermal power and thermal conductivity. But basically these two are in conflict, these material properties, because the electrical conductivity and thermal conductivity usually scale linearly in the electronic part. Also, this material, as electrons are moving, also generates heat by itself, and the minimum thermal conductivity basically limited by electronic components. So basically we are in conventional thermoelectrics, we are only using charge. So why not to employ the spin of the electron? And that is the subject of the field of spin calorimetrics. Basically, spin calorimetrics deal with the mutual interaction between spin, heat, and charge in materials. This effect gained a lot of interest in the year after the year 2008, when the spin-Seebeck effect was discovered. Basically, then the field started to gain a lot more attention. Spin-Seebeck effect basically generates thermoelectricity using the spin current instead of electron currents. Basically, the ingredients for spin-Seebeck effect is, as I say, spin current, which is a flow of angular momentum, and electrical detection of this angular momentum flow, which is thanks to the spin Hall effect. So what I'm going to do now is start explaining basics of these two concepts. So we have seen charge current in a non-magnetic material. Basically, both the spin up and spin down electrons move in the direction of the charge flow, and there is a net charge flow but no net spin flow. In the case of a spin current, what happens is you have a transport of angular momentum. Let's say here, if you transport H bar, what happens is electrons with opposite spin orientation move in opposite directions, and you have a spin flow, but no net charge flow. Also, you can do the same in a insulating material. If you have an order, paramagnetically ordered material, you induce some spin excitation. This propagates across all the materials in the form of a spin wave or a magnon, and you can propagate a spin current as well. So in the case of spin currents, you have a angular momentum, but no charge flow. So the question is, how can you detect this spin current? Basically, the spin current is detected by spin Hall effect. So to understand the spin Hall effect, we can first just look at the conventional Hall effect. In the conventional Hall effect, what you have is when you flow a charge by the action of a magnetic field, you get a force in the perpendicular direction to these two, which deflects the electrons. So in the case of the spin Hall effect, is pretty similar to this. What happens is also you have for the pure spin Hall effect, you have a charge flow and the spin polarization of the electrons, And basically you get the spin current, which is generated in the perpendicular direction to these two. So you can see here that the electrons with opposite spin are deflected in opposite directions, and then you have a spin current generation. This effect is present in materials with strong spin-orbit interactions, such as platinum. And the efficiency of the effect is given by the spin hole angle. Actually, this was first observed in semiconducting material by optical methods. Here, they established an electric field in this direction. And by the action of magnetic field, they could see how there was a spin accumulation of opposite signs on the edges of the opposite edges of the material. But what we need to use in the spin Seebeck effect is the inverse spin hole effect. Basically, this is the reciprocal of the previous one. What we have now is you have a spin current. By the spin-orbit interaction, you generate a charge current in the direction perpendicular to both the spin current and spin polarization of the electrons. You can see here the electrons, there is the spin current injected, and the electrons with opposite spin are deflected. In this case, they are moving in opposite directions, so they are deflected to the same direction as the material, and they generate a transversal voltage, basically the inverse spin hole effect voltage. Also, efficiency is also given by, as before, by the spin hole angle, which also tells you the sign of the voltage you expect to measure. We can see here, like materials with low spin orbit coupling, no effect. And the material which is most efficient usually is platinum, and is what is mostly used for all these spin Seebeck effect experiments. And that's what I have used for my experiments too. So now we know the ingredients of the spin Seebeck effect. And to measure it, what you do is you make a bilayer of a ferromagnet and a non-magnetic metal like platinum of very thin, like 5 nanometers. What you do is by applying a thermal gradient, you excite the magnetization dynamics. As I showed before, you generate a magnetic spin current. And then this is injected at the interface with the metal, and thanks to the inverse spin hole effect, you generate a voltage which is transverse to both the thermal gradient and the spin current and the magnetic field, which defines the spin polarization. In this case, the figure of merit, the parameters are decoupled. The thermal conductivity of ferromagnet and electrical conductivity of metal are decoupled from each other. Also, since it is present in insulators, has potential for lower heat dissipation, and we can study a new range of materials. Actually, this slide is just a comparison of what I have shown, kind of summary of what I have shown so far, the comparison between Seebeck and spin Seebeck. You see interrelated properties which get decoupled. You have your heating, and your heating is not present. So also, there is another advantage. Here you generate a longitudinal voltage, but in the case of the spin Seebeck effect, what happens is you generate a voltage which is at the right angle between the heat flow direction and the magnetization direction. So basically, thanks to this geometry, you can just fabricate devices by thin film coating over surfaces. And since you can fabricate very thin film layers, you can generate voltage with just thin film nanometer scale device. Also, the power scales with device area. The larger the area, the more power. And you can see if you want to make a conventional device using Seebeck effect, you need a very complicated array of thermocouples, which are connected in parallel, thermally in parallel, and electrically in series. So basically, this is one example of how a specific device could be using for microchip. You could just deposit a layer of this specific device and just extract current from it using the kit in the microchip. Also, there are many other hot surfaces like power plants, automobiles, textiles, microprocessor, even photovoltaics, which only use the visible spectrum but not the infrared. So, however, there is one problem. The magnitude of the spin Seebeck effect is very small, just a few microvolt at the most. So there is a strong interest in how to increase the magnitude of the spin-Seebeck effect. One approach is based on the increasing the detection efficiency of the spin-Seebeck effect. Well, this can be done, for example, playing with the spin hole angle of the detecting metals. You can create a zigzag structure and add the voltage from each of these lines to increase the detected voltage. Other approach was used by trying to improve the injection efficiency at the interface by introducing some materials to improve the spin mixing conductance, it's called, at this interface. Other approach was trying to use nano composites to increase the bulk to area to bulk ratio. Sorry, the surface area to bulk ratio. Another approach can be using other spin conversion paradigms like spin momentum locking in topological insulators or rush by spin orbit coupling. But today I'm gonna show something different because my approach is not based on any of these. The approach we have followed is based on the enhancement of the spin current itself. So we have used two methods here. One is the spin-Seebeck effect in multilayers, and the other is a magnum polaron spin-Seebeck effect. So let me start from the spin-Seebeck effect in multilayers, where I will show you that there is a voltage enhancement. I will show you the spin-Peltier effect and some spurious contributions which can appear as well. So what we have done is create multilayers by growing a stack of ferromagnet normal metal bilayers. In this case, you expect to have a constant spin current in the device, and you could have an enhancement of the, in the conventional conditions, you could have enhancement of the spin-Seebeck effect by injection, because you increase the number of interfaces multiplied by two at the limit of infinite layers. And also because you are connecting many layers in parallel, you expect a reduction of resistance and an increase in thermal power in these devices. The devices which we have made are magnetite platinum multilayers. Basically, platinum is the best material for the spin current detection. Magnetite, because we have a lot of experience, is a robust ferrimagnet. It has a moderate electrical conductivity, so the spin-Seebeck effect is the dominant mechanism in these devices. And it was easy to make, relatively easy to make heterobitaxial structures. Actually, these were grown by Irene in INA in the PLD system there. Actually, this system is very nice. It has PLD and sputtering, so you can make these multi-layer structures without breaking the vacuum. Actually, if you look at the quality of this, these were measured by Miriam in INA as well, in LMA. You can see that the quality of the platinum layer is very good. It's kind of single crystalline. Also, magnetite crystal quality is also very good. So we have very, very good samples to do measurements. So what we did is we prepared the sample and put it in under a thermal out of plane thermal gradient with a magnetic field in plane and detect the transversal voltage. Here we show the results for this type of multilayers with 70 nanometer platinum and measure at room temperature. We can see that between 1 and 6 multilayer, there is a large enhancement of the spin-Seebeck effect voltage by a factor of almost 5. If you plot the saturation voltage, you can see it increases by almost factor of 5. Tends to saturate. And if you look at the previous picture, which I show, of the what do you expect in the multilayer, in the case of infinite layers, what you expect is a twice increase of the spin-Seebeck effect voltage. But what we have seen is a much larger increase in our case. So why do we have such a large increase? In order to understand this effect, we could explain it by the Actually, this was explained by a group of Makawa, by Hirotodachi and Makawa. They came up with this model in which you, by using the multilayers, you relax the boundary conditions. This is a single bilayer which has to have zero spin current at the when the sample is finished. But in the case of multilayer, well, since you sample in the middle layers, you don't necessarily, you don't need to have zero spin current, and the continuity of the spin current is another ingredient. Basically, you have a relaxation of the boundary conditions, and you can have an increase of the spin current in the inner layers of the multilayer. And basically, we can detect this thanks to the fact that we have platinum inserted within the multilayer sample. And actually, using their model, we can explain, qualitatively explain the observed results and enhancement of the spin current. Also, we measure on another samples with a lower thickness of platinum, and the behavior is quite the same. It's a large increase of the voltage by a factor of even more than 5. I think here is almost order of magnitude. And there is a reduction of the device resistance. So we measure the power delivered to a resistive load. And we have seen that in comparison to a single bilayer, we have a very large enhancement of the power by 2 orders of magnitude, 100 times increase. So basically, we have seen enhancement of the spin CVK voltage and the power, spin CVK power. So now then we went on to move the reciprocal effect. Basically, the reciprocal effect is the spin Peltier effect. In this case, you use direct spin Hall effect in the platinum layer. So you inject a spin current into the ferromagnet, and with this spin current, you can establish a temperature difference. Using the locking thermography, basically an infrared camera, we can detect also in the multilayers. Here we have the infrared images. This is a single bilayer amplitude and phase, and this is a 6 bilayer multilayer. We see a very large increase of the amplitude of the temperature difference in the sample. And this is the experiments plot the ratio of the spin Peltier effect of a multilayer with respect to a single layer. We see a very large increase of factor of 40, which cannot be explained using a calculation considering simple stack of ferromagnet.
Okay, hi everyone. So that's just coming up to the hour.
In order to explain the result, we also need to consider the speed current enhancement in the multilayer. So basically, we have a check that the reciprocity in this effect, the layers. Then now I'm going to show some possible contributions from other effects in the multilayer devices. Actually, we have measured screen CVK effects so far, and we have not considered, we have assumed there is no, basically, we have neglected any possible magnetic proximity effects. But if you consider that there is magnetic proximity is possible,
great.
You could have a contribution from anomalous Nernst effect, which has basically, if you look at the equation, it has exactly the same geometry as the inverse spin Hall effect.
I can provide answers.
But there is one advantage. So the anomalous Nernst effect, you can just rotate the thermal gradient and the magnetic field.
You have access
in this case.
Don't
mind
to get certification today.
You can still detect the anomalous Nernst effect, but any spin CVK effect that is will be present to, due to any
injection
here is
not too many questions. So I assume that means you
will be zero by this geometry. So we measure the thermoelectric voltage. And we see that there is a non-zero signal in the multilayer samples.
Hopefully I'll see
if we plot this, the values of the saturation voltage, we see
So lovely to
that the steel, the specific effect is a dominant thermoelectric voltage, but around 70% of the signal comes from the specific effect, and there is like one third coming from this anomalous Nernst effect. So the specific effect is still the dominant contribution. However, we wanted to know what it's what is the origin of this anomalous Nernst effect. To do so, what we did is we grow some trilayer samples. This is the extreme case of a multilayer because you have two interfaces at the platinum, and we change the platinum thickness. Then we measure the anomalous Nernst effect in the perpendicular magnetized geometry. As I shown before here, no spin, no inverse spin Hall effect can be detected on the anomalous Nernst effect signal. And we have seen that the voltage scales with the, as the thickness of the platinum is reduced. Actually, this is a, if you extend this plot to zero and extract that data, this is what you get. You see scaling up as your thickness is reduced. Here, if you remember, I said that magnetite is a relatively bad conductor, so it can have some anomalous Nernst effect. But if we consider only anomalous Nernst effect from magnetite contributing to this passive element of the circuit, we see that we cannot explain the data. Basically, the anomalous Nernst effect contribution from magnetite is very, very small. So we cannot explain only with magnetite effect. And also, temperature dependent measurements have shown that the effect is present, anomalous Nernst effect is present even below the metal insulator transition for magnetite, which is around 120 Kelvin, the Verbo transition. We have previously measured in magnetite that there is no anomalous Nernst effect below the Verbo transition. So basically, this effect cannot be originated by the magnetite anomalous Nernst effect. So this indicates that it must be a property of the of metal layer here. And actually, for some of these samples, we have measured also XMCD, and we could detect in the absorption in the platinum edge, we could detect an XMCD signal. And the magnetic moment extracted from this was around 0.35 mu B, which is quite large, comparable to platinum iron interface. So this seems to indicate that there is some kind of magnetic proximity effect happening at the magnetite platinum interface in this case. Just bear in mind the growth temperature is not room temperature, it's higher. So if we insert this possible magnetic proximity layer into our model, we have another thermoelectric generator here. We have this equation where we know most of the parameters except the magnetic proximity, anomalous Nernst effect of the of this proximity layer, and the thickness is a fitting parameter. Using the previously measured magnetic moment, theoretical estimations, we can extract the thermoelectric coefficients for magnetized platinum. Inserting that into this equation.
Excuse me, sir.
This expression for